Good morning, everybody. Look at that, the video ends just as it's time for class. How are we all doing? I'll get your COVID message. You're ready. Click, click, clicking. All right, let's get class underway. So, hope everybody's doing well today. If I understand correctly, today is today the day that everybody officially goes online? Or is that starting tomorrow? Yee. Okay. Well, this was kind of what I was expecting to happen. In all honesty, I'm surprised it took so long. But there's no change for any of you. So nothing to freak out about for this class. Everything will remain the same. We will be online. We will have Twitch. We will have still our term project presentations on our final exam slot. And that's about it. So if you are freaking out about your other classes suddenly transitioning to online, at least you have a nice constant here. And that is some darn good coffee. I do say so myself. Anyway, homeworks 3 and 4 group have been graded, so that is all up on Blackboard for you to peruse. I gave everybody feedback. For some reason, I could not get group-related submissions set up for homework 3. I don't know why. Blackboard was just being a pain for me. But you all got individual feedback, and everybody in the group got the same feedback. So the only thing to take from this is that I looked mainly at, for instance, with your SRS and your use cases, I was mainly looking to make sure that it was formatted correctly, that everything made sense. I gave individual feedback on the requirements for you all. I didn't, like, double penalize you or anything like that. It was mainly formatting and making sure that everything was there. The use cases were all pretty good as well. I mean, honestly, if you all submitted the work and did it, I was happy more or less with it. A few nitpicks here and there. Some groups are missing like boundaries in their use case diagrams. Some people used, I think they used squares instead of ovals for the use cases, which is only a problem because the square means something. If the square didn't mean anything, it wouldn't be as big of a deal, but square means object, and you have to be able to differentiate that from use case. But I mean, overall, everybody did pretty well. So I was very, very happy with everybody's efforts. And let's see what else. So your homework is due Monday, I believe. And depending on how today goes, we're going to do a lab in class. It's either going to be Friday or Monday. Just kind of depends on how today goes. So I will send out an announcement when that is going to happen, basically to break things up. So we're going to get the... Oh, yes, that's right. Thank you. I do need to put that together. Let me take another note in Vim. So you need final report requirements and feedback from teammates, from classmates. Yes, because I promised you that. That is on my list of things to do. Can see it right there. Yeah, so the feedback was all, honestly, it was pretty good. So you will definitely get to see that. Yes. I didn't notice anybody being mean or anything like that, so I have to filter it a little bit. But yeah, give me a few days to aggregate that, because it's all kind of sporadically applied all over the place. Alrighty, so today we are going to get into testing. So we are going to kind of work at this backwards in a way. We're going to start with test-driven development, because this is kind of an interesting topic. And then we're going to go into the finer points of testing, and that's probably going to take maybe a decent chunk of the rest of the semester. Because we're going to talk about verification and validation. It'll be lots of fun. Basically, everything that you've learned so far has been how to construct a project and how to manage it and how to refine your artifacts, right? How to get everything in its proper location. Now we're going to look at the flip side. We need to make sure that everything works. And it's not as simple as clicking compile and it compiles. And good, you're done. Which is the engineering joke. If it compiles, it's good, right? No, we have to make sure that all of your everything, basically your artifacts, your tests, or sorry, your functions, your classes, your packages, everything needs to link up to some kind of a test. And those tests have to pass. There are multiple ways that you can handle testing. We're going to talk about a handful of them today. We're going to look at unit testing and a couple of other ones. But there is, if you look at testing, like you go to Wikipedia or any of the tech blogs out there, there are just tons of categories of different types of tests. And let's assume that you get that taken care of. You can even go crazy, go exploratory, and do automated testing. You can do testing that uses search algorithms to find tests that you never would have thought you needed. You can prioritize testing. You can order them. There are a lot of topics to talk about with testing, basically. It all comes back to, though, making sure that your software is working and that you can prove to other people that your software is working. With testing comes this notion of trust and user acceptance and auditing and all of these kind of topics that we don't always really think about when we're writing code or developing projects, but they're very important because if people don't trust your company or they don't trust your project team, they're not going to use your product. A very wonderful example of this is, again, go back to my automotive industry days. I don't think it was our company. I think it was one of our competitors. But when you're working in automotive, you have a safety rating for your company, and they screwed something up, and that rating dipped, and then they started losing customers because you can't trust people anymore. Or it goes to that VW thing where they were faking their tests, right? So that's one of the other issues that we can have where we pretend that our tests work. But it all comes down to trust and making sure that everything is good. If you can prove that all of your tests are passing and that they're doing what they should be, you're fine, right? Now, this is also, just to kind of elaborate further, I'm talking about test-driven development today. This is hopefully to give you a nice little firm push into doing testing, because we often think of testing as that thing that you do when you're done writing code. Test-driven development is where you do your testing either before you start writing code or alongside of it. And this is kind of, again, the impetus for making you write these test cases. So if you don't do it while you're developing, it's going to be all this extra effort later on, and it becomes a really big pain and a lot of work. So that's kind of setting the stage for today. Now, we have a few different types of test-driven development that we're going to look at. They all relate to a visual of a traffic light. So red, yellow, green. Basically, just kind of keep that in mind as we go. We'll talk about some of them. We'll look at two different strategies for TDD. And then hopefully we'll wrap up with some examples of testing and the fun stuff. But we're also going to talk about unit testing. So ideally requirements, then diagrams, then tests, then programming. If you're following test-driven development, yes. More often than not, what happens is you do programming and, well, it depends on your workplace, right? So if you're following, so this is almost a lot of this test-driven development stuff was written by people who follow or who I think created extreme programming, so the agile paradigm. Am I not presenting? Oh my God. Can you hear me now? A little bit high. Am talking. Can you all hear me? Okay. Yeah, so I was trying. That's probably really loud because I clipped. Thank you. I was trying to get rid of my little USB attachment here, and I tried the stereo, the other jack on my headset to get out of the way because my USB cable is like right where my mouse is. So apparently broke things. Fun. Alrighty. So we're going to talk about testing, but what I want to start with here is what do you consider a test to be? Because we really haven't talked about what test cases are or test suites or software testing specifically. And I'm kind of curious to see what you all know of testing at this point. But to go back to the question about the process, it's going to depend on your environment. Some of you might follow in a more agile strategy and you write tests alongside your programs. Some of you might follow a more waterfall or V model or spiral type strategy where you write tests after you're done programming. Or you have a group that works on your test cases in parallel to programming. It just kind of depends. But the point of testing basically is that you need to be doing it at some point, so you might as well get it out of the way. I have only worked with J units, so we're going to look at J units a little bit. So this one is a word cloud poll. So if things start making like getting a lot bigger, that's why. Yeah, so unit testing is the smallest piece of testing that we can do. Right, and if you all did JUnit with Intro to Java, then you at least have a basis of understanding. Make sure your code be working. A controlled experiment with a desired outcome, checking for functionality. So to me, this is not a word cloud. This is a random, let's randomly size everybody's inputs. Yeah. So we're checking that our code is doing what we say it should be doing. And what should it be doing? It should be following the requirements that we have derived for them. Right? If I have a function that is taking a string input and parsing it out into XML, I should have a requirement basically saying how that transformation should occur. The test case should test basically your requirement or whatever artifact you're looking at, right? Could be some kind of a UML model. But you should be finding the correct behavior. Hey, text size random. There we go. But yeah, basically you're checking functionality. So one of you there said that they only formally worked with JUnit. So again, that's the nice kind of bolted on unit testing framework for Java that pretty much everybody gets experience with. And there's actually a lot of really cool extensions for JUnit that I've seen. One of the like the niftiest ones, somebody in research anyway, there is a tool out there that analyzes the Java bytecode of programs. So basically you don't have to necessarily write tests. All of your test cases are automatically created by scanning bytecode and automatically creating test cases for you. But so that's like kind of the basis of it, right? So here would be your JUnit tests, and this is something I yanked off of Google Images. We'll do a JUnit example later on. But here we're adding in test cases for, some kind of a mathematical class, right? So it says your add numbers function makes sense. Is it invalid? We have assertions. We're checking if things are equal to each other. Basically, we're checking kind of the smallest type of thing that we can do with the unit test. That could be a function, could be a class, could be a module. Do we have to test our GUIs? For the term project, not necessarily. In general, yes. So that's a good point. My testing background is mainly in, again, automotive types of things. So you're going to get topics like functional testing and integration testing and regression testing and all those fun categories that you see in industry. But if you're developing any kind of a GUI-based application, you have GUI-related tests to run. Term project, not necessarily, unless you want to. But what is a GUI test? Well, you can run scripts that automatically fill in fields, click buttons. You can do usability testing or user testing where you give your application, right? So I come up with an app and I give it to 20 users and get their feedback. Is everything placed appropriately? Does it work okay? Are there any buttons that do nothing? Is it responsive? Things of that nature. So there are a lot of different ranges of test types. Honestly, there is a huge list out there for them. Here we have a Python? No, C sharp, sorry. I'm looking at the brackets and thinking Python. Is testing your tests a thing? Meta testing? Sure. Yeah, you can do that. That is definitely a thing. Probably not as much in industry. It seems to be more of a research type of topic that I've seen. But there are a lot of things you can do with testing. So again, C sharp has similar hooks basically for unit testing. So let's talk a little bit about the different types of tests and why it's so important. So one of the things that you may learn over time is the testing, at least what you've done so far probably, runs really, really quick, right? You run your JUnit tests, doesn't take very long, right? It just is checking all your functional outputs and inputs and things of that nature. Okay, maybe start going a little bit crazy. You add in teardown, setup hooks for like instantiating and destroying objects. You start adding a little bit and a little bit and a little bit, and your tests get a little bit more complicated. And then testing your tests might be a thing, definitely. But consider if you're working for a large company or you're working on some kind of a large application where when you click run test, that takes 3 days to run your test suite. Then testing and figuring out which tests to run when becomes a very important topic. There was a keynote by, so one of the conferences I go to is testing related. And we had a keynote 1 year from a researcher who works at Facebook. And their big thing was optimizing the testing pipeline. Because somebody submits a change to the Facebook platform, whether it's mobile or web or whatever. It goes into this continuous, the CICD pipeline, and it runs through every single test imaginable, and this takes days to run. So pretend you're a developer. You make a change to a GUI or to some kind of an API interface. And to get that change signed off, you need to pass all these tests. And to do that, you have to wait 3 days for the output of that test. So testing becomes a very heavy-handed thing. Those of you making games, how do you test your levels? How do you test your user inputs? How do you test your data state or your world state? There's a lot of things that can go into testing. So just setting the stage that this is a very important topic, and we're going to look at it kind of backwards in a way. We are not going to formalize testing. We're going to kind of leverage your past knowledge in unit testing from intro to Java. But let's talk about test-driven development. Changes background color. Yeah, pretty much. That's why people are doing all of these exploratory algorithms. Right? How do we make tests run faster? How do you make them run faster and still be effective. There is a wonderful quote, I'm going to horribly butcher it, but basically, if you're all of your tests pass, that means you haven't found the correct bug yet, or something like that. You can write as many test cases as you want, and there's still going to be a problem somewhere, basically. So, test-driven development. This is a, it's more of an agile type of thing. So again, people who did extreme programming kind of kicked off this notion. Basically, you have two rules here. So you're only going to write code if a test has failed, meaning that you're going to write all of your test cases first. And if you have a failure, you're going to write code to make that test pass. And I've got to talk about that momentarily because I don't want you all getting bad habits. So write code if we have a failure, and then you're going to eliminate code duplication and other code smells that are out there, meaning things that you think might be wrong with your code. It smells funny is kind of how to describe that. Basically, there's a list of different programming paradigms you should follow, and if you break them, they lead to code smells. Think of applying anti-patterns. That'd be a code smell would be one of those. But the thing that I really want to talk about, because I don't want to seed you all with bad habits, write code only if an automated test has failed. Don't write your code just to pass test cases. Write your code to work. Like don't write code that just makes all of your test cases turn green because then you have something that's not going to be good. Test-driven development's kind of a weird aside from this, but basically you're still writing good code, you're just making sure it passes the correct test. So, this would be the VW approach. All right, so other names for test-driven development. Test-driven design, test-first development, basically you're testing and then writing code. So the first one we're going to look at here is by Kent Beck, who created extreme programming. Again, not necessarily something we looked into in detail, but basically it's one of those agile strategies. So how does this work? I've got a link in here with a pretty good description of how this particular cycle works. If you don't like my description, the code in the article is Ruby. So if you know Ruby, you probably feel right at home. I do not know Ruby, so the code examples kind of went over my head. And I'm too old to learn Ruby, I think. He said jokingly. Anyway, what do we do for. Why do I keep losing my slide notes? Thanks, Google. So you go through this red, green refactor cycle. So red, green, yellow, basically. I've got to walk through on the next slide. But basically, what you do is you start out by writing test cases, and they're going to be empty test cases that are doomed to fail. So you start out by writing your tests. You have not written any code yet. You've written all your JUnit hooks, for instance. You've written your integration tests. You've written whatever test you need. All right, so they're going to fail. You then add a minimal code change to make that test pass. This is where bad practices can creep in a way, if you are, a new programmer or maybe not seasoned. Writing code just to pass, you see this screen, you think, oh, we're good. Let's move on to the next project. No, you have to make sure that it works in all cases. But the point is that you write code that can basically pass a test case, and then you improve it. So the point is you're going to have your test cases alongside with you as you go. You're building up a test suite to run all of these future tests, right? Regression testing is making sure that anything new you add is going to still not break old tests. Integration testing we'll talk about. That's where you take two modules, you merge them together, you make sure that you haven't broken anything by merging them effectively. So kind of the key here is building up this test library, and we'll see that with the other TDD process as well. So I was pleased to discover there is a traffic light emoji. There's an emoji for everything now, so I can just include it in the raw header here. But how would this work? Start off at the red stage. Again, write tests. You know they're going to fail because you don't have any code to instantiate them. So that's your red stage. But you have test cases, which is a good thing. Then you go to green, means that you write your code, It will pass this test in some way, shape, or form. Maybe it doesn't pass it perfectly, or it doesn't meet all of your standards. So you're then going to go into this yellow phase, which is refactoring. Fix that horrible, ugly mess of code that you wrote to pass those tests and coerce it into a nice, non-code smell driven format. Right? Make sense? Hopefully, more or less. So you all have been kind of, again, writing your code for your term projects. You have developed your requirements along the way. You've developed your artifacts along the way. Crystal clear, perfect. You haven't written any test cases yet, or if you have, you've done it without me telling you to do it. In which case, good job. But in this particular strategy, if I had told you you were following Red Green Refactor, you would write all of your test cases before you write a single line of code. And what this does, it builds up your test library, it builds up your list of test cases that you can execute. But it also kind of forces you to think about how your project is structured with respect to requirements and all your artifacts. I've got these tests, I've got these requirements. Do I have anything that doesn't match up? Like, if I've got 50 requirements for my project and I only have two test cases, well, that probably means that A, I'm going to need more test cases, or B, do my requirements maybe, or is there some duplication or redundancy in there? So this kind of gets you thinking like at a higher level in a way. But test, pass test, fix your code. And again, this is kind of where the traditionalist in me hesitates a little bit because writing code to pass test cases. And I'm not saying any of you would do this, but I could very easily see the case where somebody's maybe tired and they forget to fix the mess and they just leave a passing test. So you have to be kind of, I guess, honest with yourself for this type of thing. But that's one strategy. We have another one as well, which also relates to traffic lights. We have the test first stoplight. Basically, what you have here is you pass through green, yellow, and red repeatedly. I've got another link here with the more detail on the process if you would like. But how does this one work, and why is it different? So first, what you're going to do is you're going to prepare a list of tests, and then you're going to run through this process repeatedly. So you're going to start. You're going to write a test. That code may fail. You get a yellow light, meaning that you have a test, but things don't work. Let me just pop all these in because it's going to be easier. What we do in this particular strategy is that you have a test, so you're a green. You have a problem, meaning that you're probably missing a function call, or you have a compilation or a syntax error or something. You get a yellow light. So you then implement just enough to compile. So you add function stubs. So the example we're going to walk through in a little bit, assuming we get to it, is that let's say that I have a class. I need to do some kind of a type conversion. Maybe I need to read something from a database, some kind of activity, right? I write a test case that calls this particular function, but that function doesn't exist yet because I haven't written it yet. So that's your yellow light stage. You add a stub, which is basically just the function declaration, and it just returns nothing. So it's a stub that you fill out later. That allows your project to compile, but it's going to show a test failure. So you get a red light. Basically, you get a big red JUnit test, or you get some very angry text from the Python test framework. So then you add just enough to make it pass, and then you improve it by refactoring. So in this case, it's very similar to the other one. Basically, you kind of iterate your code. You start off by implementing something that makes sense, then you refine it over time. And basically, you go through this process over and over and over again. The key difference here is that we're adding a function stub along the way. So basically, you are making sure that your program will run. Whereas before, we didn't care. We just wrote code to pass. So the key with both of these, I've got it in bold here at the bottom. Minimize the time between writing code and writing tests. So, again, let's take a quick step back. You spend all semester writing your term projects, right? And this is a very accelerated process that you're going through. Consider a real-world production level project where it will take months to years to get something that is in a good enough state that it's ready for testing. You spend all that time writing code, and then you spend as much time writing test cases for it and then refining code. If you do them sequentially, you get a very long project. But if you write them in parallel, it's kind of like picking things up as you walk around your apartment or your house. You don't have as much time cleaning up later on. So kind of interleaving testing and developments can really help you out time-wise. One of those things that you can use to shorten the timeline of your projects. So let's look through an example of this just so that it's a little more clear for you all. So I'm going to do my best not to screw up on stream because I'm going to write some Java code, which sends the chills down my spine that I have to do that. Well, I don't have to do it, but I want to do it. Yeah. I need to figure out this Java thing one of these days. Let's do it on stream. Okay, so I'm going to create a person out of a Java class. And this favorite variable I'm going to ignore because that would be, well, it's actually part of the tutorial that I've got linked to. I've got it in there. I'm not going to write it because it's not relevant here. But I want a name for a person to be turned into an XML string, basically. So I define a person, I give them a name. The output, I expect to see angle bracket name, my name, angle bracket close name. Right, so standard XML formatting. So the green light here, we're going to create a test. Yellow light, this method doesn't exist. Excuse me. Swear the allergies in this area are insane this year. So yellow light method doesn't exist. Let's add a stub. Red light method fails because we haven't done anything. Green light, we're going to fix things. All right, so let me pull open my fresh instance of Eclipse here. And let's create a Java project. So let's call the CIS350 CSI CIS350 demo. Person demo. Java. Module name. EMF CIS350. Sure. Okay, so we have our module. Let's add a class. Hopefully this is not too painful. Allergies in my house. Just dust and whatever is floating around outside. All right, so let's call this person. Sure, let's give them a main default package. All right, so what we should see, print line, hello there. Represent the prequel memers. What have I screwed up? I'm missing my package, right? Didn't I have a package? It's a default package. EMF there? Yeah. How am I screwing up here? Package. Yeah. Doesn't like that. Have it in the wrong spot. Okay. Fair enough. Does we run? Hello there. Yay! I can do a hello world. Your 20-something eyesight ain't the best. Fine. Can we just zoom in? No, can't zoom in. Pop, pop, pop. Where is colors and fonts? Come on. Sorry about that. Where is hello there. Thank you. Anybody know the general font? Text font? Please tell me this is what I want. There we go. Okay. So I have a basic class, right? So, this person has a, what'd I say? Name. All right, so we don't need this main function anymore. Let's get rid of that. I just wanted to make sure that I defined things right. So we want string name. And let's have a creation constructor. I do know how to write code. So public person string in name. And I can't do this. Sorry, I'm a C programmer by heart. Nothing's stopping us from doing it. So this dot name equals name in name. All right, so we have a person class. Basic, beautiful, thank you. All right, so we have that basic thing. Get rid of that just for ease of use. Now what we need is a JUnit test. So let's call this person. There's probably a, so I learned there's a GVSU style guide. I have no idea what it is or what it looks like. So I'm just going to use my own style here because that's how I roll. Let's have a setup and teardown. Makes sense. I'm not going to do this. So this is one of the things where you all might be better at writing test cases than I am. I don't have JUnit 5 on my system. I'm going to use JUnit 4. And we are going to get covered for a whole 5 minutes. Okay. So I actually need to delete this. I forgot. Sorry. This has to go away. I need to add. Okay. Yes. Click. Clicking in the right spot. Project. Properties. Build path. Libraries. We need JUnit. Version 4. Apply. All right, we have that. Now, in our package, let's add a JUnit. JUnit. It's an older meme. All right. Add you. Hey, we have a test. All righty. So we have a person, and we have some JUnit testing here. And if I run this right now, I should see some failures because I have done nothing yet, not yet implemented. So that's what we see here. If you don't remember JUnit testing, this basically applies to any kind of unit testing. You usually have some kind of a setup where you might instantiate things if you need to do that, tear down. So this runs after the test, basically, if you need to destroy any objects. You know, basically, if you have any setup or remove types of stuff that happened before and after the test, respectively, you don't always need them, but they're helpful if you're doing some kind of crazy testing. And then we have our actual test cases where they have a test decorator, and then it's going to be some test that gets run. So here we're going to fail, not yet implemented. I could also say system.out.println, general Kenobi, because that's still relevant and everybody thinks it's still hilarious. There we go. My test does that. But what I need to do is to actually get back to the content here. Otherwise, we're never going to end. So I have this class. And what I want to check is that whenever I basically use this class, I want to make sure that we can turn this person's name into an XML string. Now, is this a ham-fisted, coerced example? Absolutely, which is fine. As a professor, I get to do that. It's also based on one of the linked tutorials later on in the slides. But maybe I need to insert this person into an XML tree. Or maybe I'm representing some kind of a data dictionary as XML. So create a person, add them to our dictionary later on. So I want to make sure that the person that I create matches the function as XML, right? So I'm going to have a method called as XML. So what I need to do now is I need to add a test. So let's get rid of this basic test here. At test, let's scroll down. Public, what I need to do is have more than one thing in the screen here because I need to make sure I know what I'm talking about. Okay, at test, public, void, test, person. So I'm writing a test to test my person. Assert equals name. Creativity's waning. My name. P dot as XML. All right, and what's P? I don't have a P yet. So, person P equals new person. Eric. So what have I done here? So I created a local instance to my class that I'm testing, right? So it's under test. I create an instance of me because I need to be added into the system. And just to kind of show you what this says, let's say system.out.println. This runs first. System.out.println. This runs last. Let's run. It's the short key for this project. Run. Control F11. Of course, it's complicated. Errors exist. What did I do wrong? Okay. So this runs first. This runs last is the output for setup and teardown. I'm going to get rid of these so that we don't have that every single time. But I ran my test and I got a failure, right? Got a big red error. Method as XML is undefined for the type person. So that is our yellow light. All right, we've written a test case. It fails because we don't have that method in existence. Okay, makes sense? I'm just trying to kind of follow this test-driven development idea. So we need to basically add a stub for as XML. This has to happen in the class that we are testing because that's the function we're going to be calling. So let's say XML stub. Erroni. Public string as XML. Return. Now this should be void since we're not returning anything. Just a stub. So this is a stub. We have a basic function that does nothing. Let's run again. Yes, I know errors exist. Method assert equals and the type assert is not applicable for this. Okay, so this does have to be a string. My bad. Return nothing. Test failure. What's the failure? We expected name Eric, but we got blank. So sorry, this is a little bit small here. Basically, what we've got going on is that I've got a test case. I'm expecting this to equal this. However, the stub doesn't return the correct value. Makes sense. But test-driven development, we are iterating our test cases and our code in parallel, basically. So what do we do? Oh, return null. I returned a blank string, but pretty similar to what we're going to be doing here. So the green light then to fix this, let's make the method actually do what we want. Let's instead of returning null or blank, return name plus name plus close off the XML tag. And then when we run this, green, life is good. We have passed our test case. Again, most trivial test case in the world here. We do have a little bit of a difference here, right? So we're assuming that this is the name that's being created. And again, up here, this is the person we are creating. I could run through a list of these tests where I try different names. Maybe if you have punctuation in your name, that might be a problem for XML that you have to handle. But at its core, and now we sh it passes, now we ship. The emoji there absolutely makes that statement work. Perfect. All right, so then we have our green light. And then we would iterate this, right? We would make this a little bit more. We'd get rid of code smell. So here we have some magic things happening, right? We're assuming that this is the XML tag we want. We're assuming we don't have to format name. Maybe we need to break this class apart into a subclass for handling string operations, right? There's a lot of moving pieces that we could have here. But at its core, you have a test that we've written. And again, this is something that should be reviewed for all of you, I would expect. But the key is that instead of writing these test cases, in parallel or after you're done coding, you're writing them in parallel. Now, what do you get out of this? And this is probably where we'll end, I think, because getting into this is going to take some time. So we get actual test cases that we can use, right? So we could have a laundry list of these tests that handle everything related to a person or a sprite or a calculator, right? Whatever your term projects are. You have tests. You can reuse them over time. So, good practice to get into is writing these tests as you go. And I'm gonna guess that writing unit tests hopefully got drilled into you in Intro to Java. But if not, it's getting drilled into you now, something you should be doing. You also get some nice flexibility there because if you start making changes to your code base, you start adding on new features or new modules, you know, you add in new classes, you bolt on multiplayer. He said glaring at one group in particular. If you have test cases that actually show that your code is working, adding on those features is a lot less scary. And when I say scary, if you add on a particular feature or a new something or other, you always have that concern that it breaks everything else, and then you have to go back and retest everything manually, right? But if you have a list of test cases and you can just run all of your tests, and they're all passing, you at least have a pretty good feeling that things are going well. So, ideally, gives you flexible designs. And coverage we'll be talking about in the near future, probably after Thanksgiving, near future. Basically, are you covering all of your branches? Are you covering all of your functions? Are you testing as much code as possible? Because there's test cases that don't necessarily impact everything. Last but not least, there you get nice documentation benefits out of it too. Basically, a test is effectively an atomic object. It is a small entity that you can link to requirements, you can link to design decisions, you can link to code, obviously, you can link to your UML models that show, I have tested this feature, it passes. We are all happy about this. And when I say we are all happy, you take this nice big green list of passing tests, you give it to your external auditor that comes in to make sure that you're doing what you're saying you're doing, and they're happy too, because they see passing tests. And if you really need to think about it in this way, you actually have a test specification. This is a software artifact. So if you have a list of tests, and again, they might be JUnit tests, they might be written out functional tests. They are actual software artifacts that you can link to other objects. They're effectively design documents. Other things we get out of it. You can reduce the debugging time. So if you have a problem, you know exactly where it is. Either because a test fails and you can go right to that area, you have a very narrow focus of what this test is showing you because it's looking at one function. It's looking at one class. You can ideally pinpoint things if you start doing it. That helps your debugging tremendously. If any of you have gotten into like code debugging and trying to fix things, you have a lot of print statements everywhere. It's called trace debugging, by the way. Or you start using the debugger and setting breakpoints, watching memory, things of that nature. It can get very messy if you have a bigger project. But if you have a list of test cases it ran, you just double-click the one that's red. Go right to that class. Then you start doing in-depth debugging. All right, last of these, hopefully all make sense. Basically, everything's testable. You get nice clean code. It's professional looking. Ideally, it's going to work and it'll be delivered on time. But one point that I want to leave you with before we end here today, this kind of enforces that notion of decoupling we've been talking about. So it's kind of a nice little side benefit that you don't necessarily expect to see. If you have a module that you have written a bunch of unit tests for, you're kind of by nature forced to break things apart because you're making these small manageable tests that are testing small manageable chunks, right? And you're basically forced to decouple your classes just to make this testing strategy work. Hey, thank you. I'll have to check that out in between class here. Java Stoding. Oh, God. Okay. Are there issues? Yeah. Hey. Hey, that's me. Good question. I'm on my page as well. Yep, I am doing stuff. So that's a good question. Let's end with that. Are there issues with doing TDD with Git in a team? Apologies if it's a silly question. No, absolutely not. Not a silly question. Great question. And no issues with that. So your tests that you would be writing, you could check into Git, and then everybody has access to those test cases, and they could import them into their project. Honestly, if everybody's test-driven development is not a single user thing, it could be a multi-user. So absolutely, I'd recommend everybody try to get in the habit of that. Should have probably enforced that for you all, but I figured you all had enough on your plate with everything else going on. Okie dokie. So on Friday, we will wrap this up. Monday, we'll probably do a in-class lab. That'll be kind of a nice segue into our winter Thanksgiving break. And then we will continue on afterwards. So I hope you all have a wonderful Wednesday. Looks gorgeous out, but I think it's probably cold, and you need to not be full screen. All right. Bye, everybody. Have a great day.